Thank you everyone for joining us for this webinar, Studer Vista 1 Class Part 1, presented by Mihály András and Dávid Rikk. My name is Laura Lawrence and I'm the Global Marketing Director at Harman. Just a few things before we get started. Everyone on the call is muted to keep down noise levels during the webinar. However, there is a Q&A function where you can submit questions to the presenters and they'll try to answer as many questions as possible at the end. This webinar is being recorded and the link will be made available a few days after this presentation. We do have a number of other webinars taking place over the next few months for audio, lighting, video, and control, and we'd like to encourage you to take a look at the different webinars in our Learning Sessions Workshop series on pro.harman.com. We're adding new sessions daily, and we have over 20 sessions scheduled for July and August, so watch for those on the calendar. And now I'd like to introduce you to Mihály András and Dávid Rikk, the presenter for today's webinar. Mihály is a Budapest-based live sound engineer who has worked at major venues including Aquarium Club, A38, and Budapest Park. He has worked with a range of international and Hungarian artists such as Eagles of Death Metal, Wolf Mother, Glass Animals, Elephant, Ivan and the Parasol, and Zabo Balas Bandia. Dávid has been head of sound at Aquarium Club, Hungary's biggest indoor venue, for the past 6 years. He has also worked on every major Hungarian festival, including Sziget, Volt, Balaton Sound, and Ozara, in addition to touring with international acts like Sepultura and Therion. And now I'll pass it over to you, Mihály.
Thank you. So, hi everyone, this is Andrew and Dávid from Club Aquarium Budapest, and we're going to be doing a webinar for you on Studer's Vista 1 desk. So, first of all, some basic facts about the desk. The desk has 32 analog mic pre-input and 32 analog line out. It has 8 ESABU ins, 8 ESABU outs, and it has the option for optical MIDI in and out as well, but audio only. The number of available MEQs for Vista 1 is 140. MEQ stands for mono equivalent channels and buses. For example, a mono channel takes away one MEQ, a stereo channel is taking away two MEQs, and the Saran channel is taking away six MEQs. There are several extension card options. The desk is compatible with all of Studer's D21M expansion cards, such as MIDI, ASABU, Dante, etc. The desk has a total of 32 faders separated as the following. It has a fader bay which contains 20 faders, a control bay which contains 10 faders, and a master bay which contains 2 faders. The strip setup and the layering goes like this. On the fader bay you have 6 layers, and this means 6 times 20 channels. You can set this up at the strip setup. We will talk about that later. On the control bay, you have 4 layers. Here you can put your buses, auxes, groups, masters, whatever you need. The master section, it has 2 faders, and you can put your masters here. Basically, this is fully customizable, and the fader bay section comes with us with an option for reaching a secondary layer as well. All right, about input channels. Every input channel comes with a low-pass filter, a high-pass filter, a 4-band fully parametric EQ, a compressor, and a gate if configured. So this all depends on your config file, how you set up your config for the desk. Regarding aux group and matrix count, I have to tell you that Vista 1 desk does not come with the configuration tool license. It is sold with preset configurations. This means that the desk contains several preset configurations which you can load for yourself and customize, but the config tool is not coming with the Vista 1 desk. If you want to create different config files, then if you contact Studer, then you can ask them to create your config file any way you want. Or if you have someone who has a Vista 5, for example, or other Vista mixing consoles, then they might have the config tool license. So, for example, Vista 5 comes with the with this license, so you can make config files there. All right. Actually, I was studying this because I wanted to talk about aux group and matrix count, but everything depends on the config file, like how many auxes you have, how many groups you have configured, and so on. All right, regarding output, every output comes with a low-pass filter, a high-pass filter, a four-band fully parametric EQ, and or a graphic EQ, and a compressor. And like I said, you have to configure these settings as well in the config file that I was just talking about. All right, regarding FX, Vista One has two effect engines, which you can configure as dual stereo, quad mono, single two in, four out, or single four in, four out, input wise. Every input and output has an optional insert, send, and return bus for inserting external devices. And the insert, sends, and returns are fully patchable via the console's general patch window, but we will get to the general patch window a bit later. There is an option with the desk, which is called Virtual Vista. Actually, Virtual Vista is a Windows application, which can be used as an offline editor as well. The desk contains Virtual Vista. You just have to download it from the desk to your PC. And this way you can use it as an offline editor, setting up shows, setting up your own snapshots, and so on. And also one thing that's very handy with Virtual Vista, it can be used as a remote control as well. So if the desk is in the venue, is in some place that you cannot really reach, you can reach your desk through Virtual Vista and you can control the whole desk. Basically, it enables the operator to access the console from elsewhere in the facility or a totally remote location. There is one more thing that Studer offers you. It's called Vista Remote Access. So this means that you can set up a network connection on the internet with a laptop or a PC or a Mac as well. And this way you can contact a Studer engineer at Studer. And if you have any problems with the desk, the Studer engineer will help you out and he will help you solve any problem that you have with the desk. Basically, this is a virtual network connection. It's a closed, secure connection, and it can come very handy if you get stuck or if you have any problem with the desk. All right, so much for the first part. One second, David is changing my slides for me. So right now I will introduce you the surface to know your tools. So first of all, I will be talking about the fader bay. The fader bay, if you look at it, it comes with a Vistonic view. This is the Vistonic view. This is what Studer calls it. And the lower part of the Vistonic view is a touch controlled surface. The upper part has encoders and buttons. So this way you can set the actual tools that are on the Vistonic view regarding your compressors, equalizers, aux sends, but we will go through this, like what you can have here and what you can reach. Underneath you have the fader bay section, obviously with the faders. And if I will be coming from up to down, first here you will have your gain knob, which right now in this case, it's adjusting our analog gain. Underneath there are two buttons called IN1 and IN2. This is for swapping between inputs, because in Vista 1 you can actually route two inputs to one channel. Underneath there is a channel button. If I hit this, I will have some of my most basic parameters for the channel I selected on Vistonic view. Right now it has my mic gain, my analog mic gain, a digital gain, my direct out levels, my delay. If I want to delay the channel, I can turn the insert point on and off. I can swap phase. I can give phantom power. The N minus X send is here, and basically all of my aux sends right now configured. So I can send this channel into any aux, turn it on and off, and so on. Underneath there is the miscellaneous button. If I hit this, I will have my whole dynamics section, my whole equalizer section, and my panorama section on Vistonic view for the selected channel, or I mean the channel I hit miscellaneous. Underneath there is a button called bus assign. If I hit bus assign, then I can easily see on the Vistonic view where my channel is routed. So if it's in N minus X, it can be routed to my groups, to my master, to my remix. Right now it's only routed to my master one, left and right, as you can see. And with touch control, you can easily route your channels. Yes, if I go on, there is a mute button, which is obviously for muting, a solo button for soloing, an isolate button, which will come very handy. David will do the day after tomorrow another presentation about snapshots. Isolate comes very handy in snapshots, but he will tell you all about that. And there is a talk button, which enables you to send your channel onto your talkback bus. All right. So underneath my fader, there is a link select button. This way I can select my channel. And if I hold link select, I can select channels in a row and do a multi-selection. And if I want to exit this multi-selection, I just hit link select on any other channel. And right now, if I do a multi-selection, then if I move this fader, it will apply to all my selected channels, and any change regarding dynamics, EQ, panorama, or aux sending will apply to all of my selected channels as well. So I just hit multi-select, and at the bottom there is a pre-fader listen button as well. All right, in between these two times 10 faders, there is a global view part of the desk. Here I can find the label type button. This way I can swap between my user label on the desk or my fixed labels. Underneath there is a bus assign button. If I hit this, you can see all your 20 channels on this layer on the Vistonic view, and the Vistonic view will show you where these channels are routed. So you can quickly see through that each channel where they are routed actually. Underneath there is a swap fader section. We will talk about this later. Actually, I will when I get to monitor mixing. And underneath, I have my fader bank selectors from 1 to 6. This way I can select which layer I want to have in front of me on these 20 faders. Underneath this section, I have some paging arrows, so I can jump by 10 faders to the left or the right. So as you can see right now, I'm in between section 1 and 2. So this is the second part of section, one. The last 10 faders and the first 10 faders of section 2. All right, so in between the fader bay and the control bay, I have a couple of buttons as well. I will talk about these right now. There is a button called multi-select. This comes very handy if you want to multi-select channels, but not in a row. So if I hold multi-select and select a couple of channels, then these channels will be linked. The fader movement applies to all of them. And like I said, if I do any changes with the equalizer or aux sending or panorama, it will apply to all of these channels. And I can hit quit this multi-selection easily by hitting link select on any single channel again. Underneath multi-select, there is another button called link all. So link all basically applies to channel types or bus types. So if I hit link all and I hit select on one of my input channels, I will have all of my input channels selected and they will be actually linked together, and everything I do on one channel will apply to all of the channels. So if you want to quit this multi-selection like any other multi-selections, you just hit link select on any channel. But with link all, you can actually link all of your auxes. So if I hit link select on one aux, then it will select all of my auxes and they will move together. And basically it applies to my groups as well, or my VCAs. I can multi-select them with one click, and I can make changes if that will apply to all of them. All right, so much about link call and multi-select. Underneath there is a global view section. Basically, this global view section will apply to my Vistonic view. So whatever I hit here, I will have it. It will show on my Vistonic view. Right now I have mic control turned on. With mic control, I have my analog gains and my phantom power on Vistonic view for each of these 20 channels that I have on my fader bay. If I hit input, I will have my digital gains in the first row, and underneath I can swap phase. There is an N-X send button. This way I will have in the top row my direct out levels, and down here my N-X send levels. If I go on, I have a button for filter, and this way I will have my high pass and my low pass filter on the Vistonic view, and I can apply any high or low passing on my channel. One more thing. This is not an on-off button, the button here right now. It will change the scale of the low cutting or the high cutting. Anyway, I will just turn this off. Underneath, there is a button called delay insert. It will put my delay times, and I can turn them on and off for each channel on the Vistonic view, and I can turn my insert points on and off. The next button is called compression and limiter. Basically, this will put my limiter threshold, my limiter attack, my compressor threshold, and my compressor ratio on Vistonic view for each channel. So this way I can very quickly change my threshold or the ratio of my compression or the attack of my limiters and my limiter threshold. It's pretty much the same with expander gate. This way I will have my expander's threshold, my expander's ratio, my gate threshold, and my gate attack on Vistonic view for all 20 channels. There is an EQ button. With the EQ button, I will have the gains for all the four bands, I mean, on every channel. And this way I can gain my EQ or turn that band on or off. The last one is a panorama. This way I will have all of my panorama options on Vistonic view for the layer that I have in front of me. All right, if I go on, I have my aux section underneath global view. In the aux section, it's divided to two parts. It has an aux mono section and an aux stereo section. So if I hit aux mono 1 to 4, I will have all my, my auxes from 1 to 4 on Vistonic view. And basically I can do some, I can send my channels into the desired auxes, and I can turn this aux send on and off for all these 20 channels. If I select a stereo aux, this way I will have my aux send level and the option to turn this send on and off. And underneath I can change the panorama setting for the channel in the aux. So right now it follows panorama. The channel's panorama will apply to the aux send. But if I turn this off, then I can manually select the panorama of this channel in that aux that I'm sending it to. I mean, right now it's aux, stereo aux 1. All right, underneath the aux section, there is a button called pre-post, which is very handy if you want to select between pre and post sending. So if I hit pre-post, then these on-off buttons on the Vistonic view will change to pre and post. So this way, with these buttons on the Vistonic view, I'm not turning the channel send to the aux on and off. I'm actually configuring if that channel in, for example, right now aux 1 is running pre-fader or post-fader. All right, so I turn pre-post off now, and these buttons go back to on and off options. Right, next to prepose, there is a shift button. It's for reaching functions on the AUX, in the AUXes, in the brackets, because actually Vista can handle 32 mono AUXes if configured like that. So these buttons are 1 to 4, 5 to 8, 7 to 12, 13 to 16. But if I hit shift, then these buttons will apply like 70 to 20, 21 to 24, and so on. And with stereo AUXes, it's the same. So with shift, you can reach these function brackets. All right, up here, you have a part called channel processing. So with channel processing, actually, you can clear your channels. This is the first option I'm going to talk about. So if you have a channel selected and you hit the clear button, then all of these options will light up. These buttons underneath, it's high cut, low cut, delay, insert, compression, and limiting, expander, and gate, EQ, and panorama. So if I hit clear and I hit, for example, high cut, then my whole high cut section is cleared on the selected channel. And so on. I mean, if I hit clear and any of these options, then it will clear the section that I'm pushing. Basically, these buttons like high cut, low cut, delay, insert, these are for turning these options on your channel. So right now, if I have a channel, I guess, what's this, 11 selected. And if I hit compression limiting, you can see the section will lighten up as well and the button will lighten up as well. So I can see that my compressor and limiter is turned on. And it applies to the equalizer, the panorama. Basically, this gives you the option to turn on these sections inside your channel. One thing that comes very handy as well, next to these sections, like high cut, low cut, there is a copy paste button. So this will apply to the selected channel. If I select channel 11 and I copy the high cut section, then I select channel 12 and I hit this button again, it will paste it. Right now, nothing is set on this channel, but it would have done it. And also this can apply not only to the selected channel. For example, if I select with touch control, this EQ for the EQ section on channel 14, and I hit copy, then this would copy the selected equalizer section. And if I would hit paste, I actually did the paste right now, you could see it. Next to the clear button, there is an undo button. As you can see right now, I did an undo, and this goes to the last modification. So it's an undo redo button actually, but you can see how my IQ points, I'm not sure if you can see in the screen, but they are changing. All right, and there is one more button here, which allows you basically to copy the whole channel. So right now I've been pushing my fader up for input 11. I hit channel copy, I select channel 12, I hit paste, and you could see my fader came up. And actually, if there would be any settings regarding dynamics, equalization, or panorama, it would copy everything with the AUX sense. Basically, the whole channel is right now copied. All right, so much about channel processing. So right now I'm going to roll over to control bay and the control bay section. So there is a setup section here. I will talk about mostly setting up mute groups and VCAs right now. There is a button here named groups. This is a button that you can turn on and off. So if I hit it right now, you can see it's glowing, it's turned on. This way I can configure, for example, my mute groups. So groups is on, I select mute group one. And when groups is on, mute group one is selected, easily with the link select buttons, I can add channels to my mute group. So once I'm done with configuring, I just turn groups up. And you can see my mute group one is working perfectly. If I want to take these channels out from Muse Group Phone, I just hit Groups again. Groups is turned on. I go on the first mute group, and with link select, I take my channels out from mute group phone. So regarding VCAs, it's pretty much the same. Groups is turned on. I hit VCA one. I mean, I select VCA one. And now if I select any input channel, I can add them to the VCA, and next to the fader, you can actually see that it marks that I gave these channels, I've been sending these channels to VCA one. And with link select, I can take them out from the VCA. Right now I can, right now I added VCA two to VCA one. So I turn this off and I turn groups up, and basically this is how you configure your mute groups and your VCAs on the desk. All right, underneath the mute groups, we have our four fader pages. Basically we can swap between these four layers that we already configured in the strip setup that I will talk about later for you as well. Underneath the fader page buttons, you have our arrows, page arrows as well. So if you have, for example, in this second layer, if you have more than 10 auxes, which I have right now, then I just, with the page arrow, I jump to the right side, to the next section, and here I have my aux that didn't fit these 10 faders. All right. Above these faders, there is a button called contribute and reduced as well. I will talk about this later when I get to monitor mixing, and I think David will talk about it as well. Okay, so there is a view section for control bay as well. The first option on view section is called follow. So if I hit follow, then basically the Vistonic view of my control bay will follow the global view on the fader bay Vistonic view. So as you can see right now, I have auxes selected, and on my Vistonic view on the control bay, I have aux sent as well. So this way I could send groups into auxes, which I won't do right now, but it gives me the option. The other option is if I select auxes, then I will have my aux masters on Vistonic view. I can turn these masters on and off. I can adjust their level. The next one is groups. This way I will have my group masters. So as you can see, if I move this groups master, then group one master will change up here on the Vistonic view as well. There is a masters option, which will put my masters on Vistonic view. A direct out option. This way I will have all of my input channels direct outs on Vistonic view. I can adjust their level, I can turn them on and off. There is an option for bus out, which we don't use right now because in this session we don't have it set up, and minus X is not set up either. There is a matrix button, which would put all of my matrixes on Vistonic view, but in this session that I'm working in right now, I don't have any matrixes set up, so this is why this whole place is blank. And there are four user buttons, which you can set up any way you wish to. Regarding the user setup, you can set it up in the GC section and in strip setup, but we will get to that later once I will go to GC. All right, I remain with follow. And there is a GC section on the desk physically as well. So this way you can reach with one button your general patch on the GC, your snapshots, your strip setup, your clipboard and library, or your channel patch as well. All right, I will go back to global view and the general patch. Okay, now I will get to just a tiny bit, not so deep, but to the patching and routing of the console. And this way I will have to show you the GC screen. All right. So what you can see on the screen right now, this is called the general patch window. With the general patch, you can connect sources and targets. and you have all kinds of sources. Right now, we will go with input ports. So we already have user labels regarding input port setup. This is why you see kick in, kick out, snare, and so on. And on the target side, I will select channel in. So this is an XY axis, as you can see. On the left side, I have my sources. On the bottom, I have my targets. And this way, these green squares show that these are connected. Now, I will tell you how you can make these connections, these routings on Vista 1, for example, between input ports and channel ins. So you can simply, I will deconnect now, I just double click. So when this square is empty and you can see that your source side is white and your target side is white as well, this means that these neither have a connection. If you want to make a connection, the easiest way is by double bringing the mice there on the square and double clicking on the left mouse button. So I just did that. This way the connection is created and you have a connection, easiest way. I will deconnect now. You can create a connection by right clicking as well. And then the first option in this menu, this way you will make a connection, right click again. And the last option, this way you deconnect. There is another option here. You can create a secure connection, I mean a protected connection. If you just simply hit on this lock, then this connection will turn red and you have a protected connection. If you want to open this protected connection, then you right click, hit the lock. It will ask if you really want to unlock the target patch. I will unlock it, but this way it won't be deconnecting. So the connection remains, as you can see, it's just not a protected connection anymore. And the third way, is you on the desk you have buttons for it. So if you select a square on the general patch and you hit make connect on the desk, it will make a connection. If you hit clear connect, it will clear the connection. All right, there is one option that can come very handy as well. If I do a multi selection between sources and targets, and I hit the right, it didn't want it to keep the multi-selection. I hit the right mouse button. Why on earth isn't this working? All right, third time. Multi-selection. All right, I hit the right mouse button, and if I hit auto, it will fill it up with the consecutive sources and consecutive targets. As you can see, this is what I just did. All right, I will tell you a couple of words about color coding, which I already told you that if the square is green right over here and the channel source and the target is green as well, then it has a single connection. If the square is yellow, for example, and here you can see the target is yellow as well, this means this target has multiple connections. So in this case, this is a stereo channel right over here, and it has two input ports connected, left and right, connected to it as well. This is why it's yellow. And I already showed you a protected connection before. If the square is red, then it has a protected connection. All right, basically, this is what I wanted to tell you about, some basic routing, input routing regarding the Vista one. So next, is setting up my fader strips. I can set up my fader strips in strips setup. If I want to reach strip setup, I can go to the view. I can hit the view button here in the GC and hit strip setup. Or there is a button on the desk as well in the GC section called strip setup. If I push it, I will have my channel strips in front of me. So basically this window allows me to assign DSP channels onto the Vista surface to faders. And it has some other options as well. If I do a multi-selection on these faders, I can add some fader glow as well for quicker navigation. So right now I gave some fader glow to these channels, and as David shows you, I'm not sure if you can see it right. I will give some different color, choose a different color, for example, make it white. Yeah, probably you see it, but my selected channels are turned white right now. So I will just turn them back to no color, and it's no color right now. All right, so much about fader glow. There is an automatic color coding for fast channel identification regarding outputs and buses. So down here, I will switching from fader bay to control bay. Here I have my four control bay layer. As you can see, the groups are identified with the green color. My master is red, my auxes are orange, and my VCAs are green.
Blue,
sorry. All right, I'm blind. So one more thing, there is a slow channel meter to keep an eye on your levels. Right now, I only have input coming on my first channel, but as you can see, this gray thing moving here, this channel meter, it shows me that I have input on channel one. If I would have input on more channels, then I could see my input levels this way. All right, I will tell you now how you can set up a section or a layer. So the most easy and the easiest way is if you just select one fader, you hit right click with the mouse, and then you can select any input, group master, or whatever you want to route to that fader. By holding the left mouse button down, you can multi-select faders. And this way, if you select, for example, one input, it will fill the faders up with the consecutive channels. So the consecutive faders with the consecutive channels. Right now I did this, and I will make it empty again. If you double click on the section, it will select the first 10 faders in a multi-selection. And if you click three times, it will select the whole section. So this way you have a multi-selection and you can actually fill these faders up. I mean, you can assign these faders to DSPs and DSPs to these faders. All right, one more thing that comes very handy, that this page, I mean, this section works drag and drop. So if I, for example, multi-select, I don't know, all of my vocals, and I want to move them to section three, so my third layer, I can just drag and drop and move them. And right now I will put them back. Just a second. This is amateur hour with the mouse. All right, and now they're back where I had them before. So consecutive channels, yeah, I told you this virtual channel strip. All right, I think I'm done. Thank you, David is loading my next slides. And in the meantime, I will load another title. So, yes. All right, so here we are again. I will turn this back from the GC so you can see what I'm doing. So lesson two, console structuring for live situations. On the go, your own show file and being the local support. So the role of the local support. I don't know if any of you guys work in a venue or you only work with bands. But if you work in a venue, then probably I don't have to tell you, there always should be a local support at any venue if a production arrives. If you're that local support, then it's fairly, they fairly think of you that you know the desk, you know every equipment, you know the PA, the processors, everything in that venue. So you're the one who will be helping the band and helping them set up and so on. Basically, what did I want? If you arrive, so when you, yeah, there should always be a local front of house guy. All right, sorry. So what I've been trying to talk about is that there's always a local guy. And if right now I'm going to be talking about the option when you are with a production and you're with a production, you're mixing the production and you arrive to a venue. So probably before you arrive to a venue, you already exchanged some emails or you talked on the phone with the local engineer or the management of the venue. So probably the local guys already have your rider and already know what to expect from the band. Once you arrive, the local guy will help you, the local engineer will help you setting up the desk. This is his role. He will help you with all the local stuff. If you're the local support, this is another case, then it's fairly expected from you, of course, obviously, to know the desk, know all the desk features. This time I will talk about it's very handy to create show files for your own for different options. So basically, if you have a show file, for example, for front of house only, if the desk is in front of house, and then you might set up a show file if the desk is in front of house, but you have to do monitor mixing from front of house as well. So this way you set up your auxes and everything is prepared for mixing monitors from front of house. Or if you have a show file for if the desk is doing only monitoring, then basically that's a different show file as well. And it's very handy. If you have these, you can have your input and output patch already routed and done, your buses, effects, any way you like them set up, which gives a very good quick start. So the third option is when you're with a band and you have to, for example, you arrive to a festival and you have to mix on a locally preset desk, which is already set up for a festival. So local desks are mostly set up with a pre-made festival patch. And right now I'm talking mostly about the hard patch. The reason for doing this is when they have very short changeovers and you have to, you know, get one band down from stage and put one band up in 15 minutes or 20 minutes, then it's much easier if the hard patch on stage stays constant. So they don't have to do all the plugging over and over and over again, and the channels are not changing. So for example, this way, channel one is always kick in, channel two is always kick out, channel three, and so on. I will show you a typical festival patch just in a second. Basically, the role of this patch is to fit all of the bands that will play on that stage. So you will have a long channel list, but you won't be using all of your channels for every band. You will only use the channels that the actual band is actually needing at the time. So yeah, the hard patch stays constant. Yeah, however, you can have your own show. This is what the big advantage of digital desks are, that the way I showed you in strip setup, we can assign faders to DSPs any way we want, and we can do all kinds of configurations. So this is like a typical festival patch. You can see that in the gray row, you have all your input channels marked and signed. And in the gray row, there is it's written instrument, so that stays constant. This is your hard patch. And next to the gray row, you have the input for band one, for example. You can see band one is only using one kick in, a snare top, snare button, a tom, two toms, hi-hat, and so on. So this way you can set up the desk for this band that you won't be having any blank spaces on the desk. So it will be, for example, for band one, fader one will be kick in, fader two will be snare one, fader three will be snare one bottom, and fader four will be tom one. So you see, you won't be having blank spaces like in this picture. Yeah, and yeah, we have a couple of examples for you as well, like band three, band four, and so on. And you can see some of the channels stay blank because they simply don't have any instrument for it. But like I told you, the strip setup, with the strip setup, you can set it up that you won't be having any blank spaces. And the engineer who's mixing that band will have only those channels in front of him that he really needs. All right. I will talk about decisions based on the time you have for sound check. So I will just clear this channel totally.
Right.
So optimally, in an optimal world, actually you will have all the time you need. But there are scenarios when you have to fit in a time window, like the ones I talked to you about before, when you're on a festival. Then sometimes you just have to fit in 15 minutes and you have to do the whole sound check. So basically you can imagine that in 15 minutes you cannot do all the job that you want to do with your band and with your channels and so on. I will tell you how David and I do it most of the time. I mean, how the process goes for us from channel to channel, from channel to channel. I will play back for you now a single vocal channel, and I will show it for you on that vocal channel.
And it is important that this is the case when you work from scratch and you don't have your own show file. So when you have to start from zero.
Yeah, right. When you don't have a show file and basically from scratch. So this is just a basic vocal channel, but this could be any channel. Basically, the process for us is like finger goes to zero. And then we will start the gaining. And once we feel like our gaining is done, if this would be a drum channel, a quick kick channel, or a tom channel, probably I would do some gating right now. But since it's a vocal channel, I will go to the EQ section. So I will turn my EQ off. I mean on. And do some echoing. And I will turn the low cut on as well. With filters. All right, so the low cut applies. I will do some more EQing. I think that's very okay. And then I go to my dynamic section, turn it on, turn my compressor on, set my attack and release time, my ratio, I do some gaining, and so this is how I would do it if I would have all the time. And once I'm done with all of this, of course, if there would be some panorama needed, that I would have done some panorama, and I would send this vocal to my vocal plate, and basically this is it. But the process is like fader to zero, gaining, gate if needed, equalization, and then compression, and then send to FX. This is just our way. This is the way we think. Everyone has their own method. So yeah, basically probably you guys have as well. So right now I will talk about one more different situation when you're running short on time. So basically you don't have the time to do all the compression and all the, you know, setting up FX and all the time to really mess around with your channels. Then basically what I and David would do, we would only go with fader to zero, have our gaining done, that's very important. Have, if gate is applied and needed, then we would have our gates done. I mean on kick, on snare, if you want it on snare or toms, because it's not so much fun to mess around with gates when the show is already running. And our equalization on each channel done. And we would go through channels like this. So fader to zero, gaining, gate if needed, equalization, and that's it. Because this way, if you only have, like, for example, 15 minutes or 20 minutes, even then you have, for example, 20 channels or 15 channels or 18 channels, probably you'll get through all of your channels fair enoughly. So they would sound fair enough. I mean, all of the channels. And this way we would leave the rest of the job for the couple of, I mean, the first couple of songs. So in the first couple of songs, you can set your dynamics and mess around with your FX and do some minor adjustments. This is totally for saving time and you know, to do a roll mix and then do the scratchy parts on when the band is already playing. Yeah. So there is an option sometimes when for example, the band playing in front of your band, they travel with their own desk, and this gives you some time to work with the work on the local desk. So this gives you the options to set up some stuff on your channels. I mean, if you know your band very well, then you might set up even EQs if you know your mics and your inputs very well. But anyways, if you're not so sure in yourself, then basically gives you the option to set up, for example, compressors. If you know that basically on your kick or your snare, you want a 50 millisec attack and a 100 millisec release, then you can already set this up. You can set up some effect parameters as well. You can turn the high passes on. So this can come very handy because basically you won't be starting from scratch. You will have most of your stuff already in the desk. So, and one more thing regarding if you want to preset compression, then obviously we wouldn't, at least I wouldn't mess around with the threshold yet. I just set up ratio, makeup gain, attack release, and when I go to soundcheck, I only have to, you know, adjust the threshold and this way adjust the compression. Right. You can also do effect sends. So if you already send your channels, but you leave your FX returns turned, I mean, you leave them in mute or you just leave the faders turned on. And once you get there, you just turn your fader up and you listen if this is the kind of effects you thought about or how much you want to apply in the show. All right, this is a basic FX page. I will show you some FX settings as well. So basically right now, these are my three effect return channels. It's a drum plate, a vocal plate, and a tape delay. But what I want to talk about how you set up effects. So you select your effect like this on the touchscreen, and this way you have your options for selecting reverbs, delays, dynamics, anything you wish. And inside these groups, you have like small hole, large hole, drum hole, different options, different reverbs. And you can record them. And basically this screen or sort of screen like this will appear and you can mess around with your effects parameters easily reached from the effect return channel. All right, so another subject. Why you should prepare and or carry your own show file. So your own show file can make your life like very, very super easy, but there are different options here as well. So if you have your band and you travel, you have your own mics or you have the same inputs all the time. I mean, the band is carrying always the same equipment, same instruments, same microphones, same DIs, then it's obvious that you should have a show file because it comes, I mean, basically you can have your whole show set up. You can have your gaining set up, you can have your EQs, your effects, your dynamics, and everything set up. And this can save you a lot of time. Because if you get to a festival stage, for example, and you have 50 minutes for a sound check and you have a show file like this, then basically your channels are basically set up. This way you only have to mess around with the PA and the master section. I will show you one more thing on the master section on the control bay. So I will show you the dynamics and the parametric and graphic EQ section for your output. Regarding, right now I'm going to talk about your master output. So right now, as you can see, I have my master one output here. This way I can open its dynamic section easily on the Vistenic view. Basically all my options and everything I want to set on the dynamic section are available here. Underneath there is the EQ section. And on the left side, you could see par written. This means if I click on, if I hit the left side, I will have my parametric IQ section for my master on the Vistonic screen. If I hit the right side, which says GEQ, I will have my graphic IQ section on the screen. So I can adjust this with these faders, I mean these encoders on the Vistonic view as well, or I have an option for fader swap. This way I will have all my bands on my master faders. And if I hit it again, then my fader swap goes back to normal. All right, this applies to all of my outputs groups. It's pretty much the same with the dynamics and the IQs and the graphic IQs on the auxes, on the master, and so on. So anyway, the first option I told you about is the option when you carry your own instruments, you carry your own mic. So basically you have everything with you. You don't ask anything from the venue, only the PA or some wedges on stage, or not even that, because you might have ear monitors. The other option is when you travel with a band and you ask for backline, for example. Probably they will play on this, they will ask for the same backline, the same instruments. So we can say that this way the instrument size stays pretty much constant. But if you don't carry your own mics and you always go with the venue's mics and DIs and so on, it can still come very handy to have a show file for the desk. Because like I told you, you can already have some compressor or dynamics settings in your show file already set up. Your effects can be set up as well. So basically, if the input side is changing only DI or microphone wise, then you will only have to mess around with some gaining and some minor EQ adjustments. So this can save you a lot of time still if you have a show file but you don't carry everything for your production. Yeah, so much about show files. Now I will talk a bit about mixing monitor from front of house. So most of the times there is a monitor engineer and a monitor desk dedicated for monitor mixing, but sometimes the venue is just too small, or they just for some reason didn't bring any engineer or any desk, or basically the band wants you or likes you to do their monitor mix because you carry an in-ear system and they like your taste and they trust you better than a random engineer. Then there are options and, you know, events when you have to do monitors from front of house. So in an optimal case, your channels will have enough input levels to feed your auxes, which are feeding your wedges or your in-ear monitors, or yeah, these are the two options actually. So this means your input channels have sufficient input to feed your master, and they have sufficient input as well to feed your auxes and your monitors. If this applies, then probably everyone will be happy. Your monitor volume will be sufficient for your production. This can depend as well. I mean, if you're not traveling with in-ear monitors and it's not your own, and you ask for wedges on stage, you might have to do some feedback control with your graphic IQ on your auxes, or probably I would start with not turning my auxes on, so I would just turn their volumes down, and once I'm done with sound check or during the sound check, I would check the level of the wedges so I don't kill my musicians on stage. However, there can be several kinds of problems with mixing monitors from front of house. First one is like a typical mistake that your monitor master is accidentally muted or the fader is not pushed up. So one more thing, mostly we do monitor mixing with auxes, with aux buses. So right now in this show file that I'm showing you, my monitor mixes are aux mixes, and I'm feeding virtually my monitors via these auxes. So one basic mistake is that my auxes are in mute, for example, or their faders are turned down. yeah, this can be easily solved. You unmute your bus and you turn your faders back up and hooray, you have your monitors running. Sometimes the virtual amplifier might not be turned on or the volume is turned down. This means you will have to ask the local engineer, hey, David, go on stage. There is something wrong with the wedges, and they will turn the amps on or their volume on. Sometimes the system processor for the wedges are not set properly because, for example, their input level is not measured, I mean, not set right. Then you will have to ask for the local engineer again to check these options like low input, low output level, or you know your wedges are limited like hell, or they are muted. These are several options, but you always have to ask for the local engineer to check their local equipment out. So sometimes the local wedge system is just too small. This way you will have to ask for more wedges. There is not really any good solution or better solution for this. And regarding ear monitors, the case might be that your musician just didn't turn his or her ear monitor on, or the level of his in-ear monitor isn't on the backpack, it's not set properly, or it's really turned down, or the battery is running dry. So yeah, the first two options, you can just tell your musician to turn it on or turn the volume on, but the battery is running dry, probably you have to do the run with some batteries. All right, so much about these problems. One important thing, when you mix monitors from front of house, your monitor buses have to be set on pre-fader. So what pre-fader means? Pre-fader means that your aux is fed before this master fader. So any movement you will do in your master mix will not apply to your monitor mix because it's sent before this fader. If you do it post-fader, then if you move this fader, for example, vocal one in your main mix, the level of vocal one will change in all of the aux as well. And actually this way it will change in the monitor mixes and musicians will be probably quite unhappy. So yeah, we most of the time we use aux buses for monitoring, but I already told you this. So on these aux buses, right now we have parametric and graphic EQs as well. Graphic EQs are mostly for killing feedback in wedges. Yeah, right now we have this setup. We can put them on sensor on faders as well. And I have these EQ options in all of my auxes. The parametric EQ, yeah, it can come handy sometimes if you want to just sculpt the mix in your in-ear mix. Then you probably won't be messing around with sharp frequencies. You will be using a parametric EQ to give any frequency or cut any frequency you wish to. So there is a trick. I will be very short on this. If you have a very needy singer on stage, but with a very loud band, and he needs lots and lots and lots and lots of vocals, and for some reason you have feedback, for example, in your wedges, you can double your single channel. So this way in the setup, you see I have vocal one on this fader, and I have another next to it, vocal one routed to the fader next to it as well. This gives me the option basically for feeding the first channel only to my master mix. The other channel, the second vocal one channel, is basically not running into my master mix at all. I only use it for monitoring. So basically, only the gain will be the same because the mic pre that's feeding the DSP is obviously the same. But I can do different dynamic settings, different EQ settings for my monitor channel and for my master channel. So this way, if I want to kill feedback or I want to sculpt this vocal in the monitor wedge totally differently, I this gives me the option so that my master mix stays like constant and it stays, I mean, my vocal one channel stays the same with my taste in the master mix. And in the monitor mix, I can just, you know, go with sharp frequencies and kill feedback, for example, in my channel as well. All right, so much about doubling vocal channel. All right, I will talk a bit about how you can mix monitors on, particularly on these decks, how you can feed your auxes, for example. So there are several ways of mixing monitor from front of house on Vista 1, but first don't forget to turn your monitor auxes pre-fader by pressing the pre-post button and selecting the desired channel. So this way, if I want to, on this desk, if I want to have all my input channels pre-fader, I just hit link all, I select all my input channels, I select aux mono 1 on the Vista EQ. I hit the pre-post button, so this way I'm not turning on and off these channels, I'm selecting between pre-fader and post-fader send. And right now, as you can see, if I hit this button, the whole row is changing, which means this applies to all of my channels. This is the easiest way for setting all of my input channels pre-fader on Vista 1. All right, I quit the multi-selection, I quit pre-post. Yeah, switch between auxes with the global view buttons. Yeah, like I told you in the first part of the lesson, you can switch between auxes on the Vista if you hear with the aux section. Do the same process, yeah, and so you don't have to. All right, so this is pre-post. This is already figured out. So how you can feed your channels into your auxes? If I have all my auxes on Vista EQ, then basically one of my easiest options is to send my channels into the desired auxes with these encoders. And I can turn the channels on and off, and I can adjust the send level. Another way is to do this, there are this is fader swap section. So basically this allows me to swap fader, and it has, as I don't know if you can see it, it says row 1, row 2, row 3, row 4, and these rows are the rows on your Vistonic screen. So if I hit swap fader row 1, basically my aux sends will be on my faders and my master section will be up here on the Vistonic view. So this is like a true swap fader, like a real swapping between faders. If I hit swap fader again, then my master sends are here and my aux sends are back up here. All right, so much about the Vistonic screen, the swap fader. And there is a third option, but this is only allowed if you allow it in your GC, and you can go to tools and you have to hit follow solo, and this has to be turned on your GC. David will show you this in a second. So if you're in the tools menu and turn follow solo on, then basically this gives you the option to do a very easy sense on fader thing on the desk. Here I have all my auxes, and if I have hit pre-fader listen on any of my auxes, then I will be in sense on fader mode. You see, these channels are in sense on fader right now. If I hit it again, then I leave sense on fader. Basically, this is my style of, if I mix monitors, this is the way I like to do it, but everyone has their own way of doing it. All right, these are the options for...
Don't forget about the contribute and reduce options.
Oh, all right, David is
that's not
letting me forget anything. So, as I mentioned, there are buttons here. It's got contribute and reduced. This way, for example, I have AUX1 and I hit contribute on my AUX1. It will only, and right now reduced is turned on. I will only see the channels that are turned on, I mean the channels that are turned on in my aux that I selected. If I hit reduced, then I will have all of my channels, even those that are not turned on the Vistonic view. And if I hit reduced, I will have only those channels that are turned on in AUX 1, for example, right now. So just to make it clear right now, I will do it with AUX 2. I select AUX 2, I hit contribute. So this way I have all my channels that are in this fader strip. And if I hit reduced, then I will only have the channels on the Vistanic view that are turned on this AUX. And thank you. Basically, this was it about the basic things about Studer Vista 1 and monitor mixing. And thank you for listening.
All right. Thank you so much, Mihály and David. That was a really excellent presentation. And there was a lot of engagement in the Q&A. I think most of the questions were answered as written answers. But Paul, were there any questions that you wanted to call out in there that might be beneficial for other people attending the webinar to hear verbal responses to?
Yes. Should I turn my camera on, actually? Let me see if I can actually start the video back up. Okay. Yes, there was a few on there. There was a question about can the Vista 1 run at 96K? The answer is no. That is only a 48K desk. The other Vistas, the Vista 5, Vista V, Vista X, are capable of 96K, but they use a different core and different processing, much larger than the Vista 1. Was also a question about additional I/O cards, Dante and so on. There is a slot on the back of the Vista 1, we call it the D21 option slot. It's a double width slot, so it can fit either two single width cards or one double width card. And thank you, I just see the presentation file going back to that. There we go. So basically on there, we can fit any of the D21 cards, which whether it's Dante, Livewire, Cobranet, an analog card, an SDI, embed, de-embed card, Blue Link. We can also use the dual MADI card from the D23. That gives you the ability to run two controlled stage boxes from the Vista 1 as well. So it's quite expandable in that respect. If you're going with the larger consoles, Vista 5, Vista V, Vista X, depending on the core type and the amount of I/O, you can theoretically go up to 6,000 ins and outs on the compact cores and 8,800, so 8,800 on the full-size cores. There's a question that just popped up that says, can you gang or group on a Studer? Yes, you can. The link select, the link options give you the ability to do a quick gang. You just simply press one link button and then you can use link all or you can use multi-select. So as you can see there, Mihály's just basically connected those faders together and then pressing any one of those will dissolve the gang in. We can also use VCA, so we have up to 32 VCAs on a Vista desk, which are literally just controls. So you have a number of ways of creating a gang type functionality. I think that's probably most of the questions that were asked. There were some pan questions as well. The panning basically can be set to standard left-right panning, or it can be set to multi-select. So you can actually have a surround channel created, a surround bus created from multiple mono channels by modifying how the panning is selected. Now you can either use the joystick or you can even use the Vistonics controls for that too. I think that's it, Laura. I think that covers most of the questions that came in.
All right, perfect. Well, just a reminder that part two of this learning session is on Thursday at the same time. So if you wanted to go in and register for that, you can find the link to it on pro.harman.com. Just click on the learning sessions up in the top navigation and you'll see it on the calendar. So if you have additional questions, you can always reach out directly. The contact information should be in that registration. or save your question for Thursday. So thank you so much for attending. We appreciate everybody's time, and we'll see you then.